opinions expressed do not necessarily represent those of Access Fort Wayne, the Allen County Public Library, or any other supporting group. Get involved with Access Fort Wayne and make your own television programming. Call 421-1250 to find out more.
Hello and welcome to the Fort Report. I'm Kevin Leininger, News-Sentinel reporter and columnist. And with me today, it's my pleasure to introduce Randy Brown, general manager of the Memorial Coliseum. Randy, welcome.
Thank you, Kevin. I'm happy to be here.
Well, thank you. Now, you've been there since 1988, I believe,
August,
give or take.
August of 88. You were the first guy to track me down when I'd accepted the position.
Well, now we're showing both our ages. But even at that, the Coliseum has been around quite a bit longer, 1952, correct?
So 60 years.
60 years this year. And it's been an up and down ride during a lot of that, but mostly up since you've been here, and I'd like to talk a little bit about that. Give us a brief rundown, if you would, of what kind of a year the Coliseum had in 2011. I know it was another year in the black, even with a bad economy.
Well, and we really bucked the trend with that. Most facilities of our type, even on a good year, lose money. So the fact that we are self-supporting is somewhat unusual. We finished 2011 off with 1,400 events, actually plus. Our 22nd consecutive year of hosting over 1 million people per year, so pretty amazing. Mm-hmm. You think in Fort Wayne, Indiana, and when I tell colleagues that, it's a wow. And lastly, and as important or more importantly, is our economic impact. And this is the events that ultimately have spin-off effects with jobs, mm-hmm. and jobs, as I like to say, for our friends and neighbors. But the economic impact of the Coliseum is right about $100 million a year, so that's a pretty significant number.
And I think you showed, as I recall, a surplus of about, what, $65,000, give or take, which is not a lot of money, but you're not really there to make a profit anyway. You're there not to lose money, for sure.
Right.
Now, the breakdown of your revenue is interesting. According to your annual report, you get no property tax, correct?
That is correct.
That's the fallback position, but we all hope that that
well,
hasn't happened.
I don't want to be the guy
while,
that
right?
has to go before the commissioners or the county council and say that we need to be returned. There was a time when the Coliseum was on the property tax
right.
rolls, but the last 25 or so years it hasn't been. But our big three in terms of revenue generators are rental fees, food and beverage revenues, in other words, when you buy a hot dog or catering,
right,
what have you.
17% of the total.
And parking, and as you would guess. And when we talk about not, our goal is not to maximize profits. That really is the key, because $4 parking, especially if you go anywhere else, but even in Fort Wayne, there are places that are charging more than $4. So again, whether it's the prices at a concession stand, trying to have something that if a child walks up with only a dollar or two in their pocket, they walk away with something. You know, now grandparent, and I want to make sure that that we're developing those future audiences, so making it affordable for everyone.
Well, you've had some good events lately and some good news. As we speak on Friday, the Comets are about to enter the Central Hockey League finals, which will be at least another two home games for you. You've had Elton John recently sold out. Other concerts, past and future, look very good. To what do you attribute Fort Wayne's success, other than just expert management on your part? But is there something unique about our facility or our location that allows us to buck the trend that you mentioned?
Well, it's interesting that with computerized ticketing, we're able to track and see just right where our ticket purchases are coming from. And at a show like Elton John, a couple key points there, it was a sellout. It was our largest crowd since we've raised the roof on the arena. And so large crowd, and it was our largest gross total ticket sales of any event we've done to date. So pretty amazing, but significant ticket sales from our regional area, Southern Michigan. You would expect Western Ohio, reaching all the way to Illinois. And the one that really continues to intrigue me is Northern Kentucky.
All the way from there.
Yeah. All the way from Kentucky. So, you know, we're easy to get to. Our roadways are very good, and we're affordable. And I think the one thing Fort Wayne has going for it over some of the other major cities around us, we're less intimidating. Mm-hmm. So people feel comfortable coming to Fort Wayne, especially if you look at the price of lodging. If you're going to make a weekend for the family and come up for a concert, maybe you're going to hit the zoo, go to the library, do any one of a dozen different things, but it's very, very affordable.
Well, and you shouldn't downplay the, you know, we talked about the age of the building, but that's the bones of it. In terms of functionality, it's much more up-to-date and almost state-of-the-art in some ways than that.
Right.
So you've constantly upgraded it. But that is one thing I think I'd like to focus on with you today. You know, do we do that indefinitely? I know you have some plans, and maybe you can enumerate those quickly in the short and kind of midterm improvements in concessions and that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But at what point do you think, and I know this isn't your decision, but do we continue to put money into the Coliseum indefinitely, or do we as a community at some point say, you know, it's a 60-year-old building or 70 or 80, and we want to look at, you know, the next generation of building? How does all that play out in your mind?
Sure. And just to say one thing, that is, yes, the arena is a 60-year-old building. The expo portion mm-hmm. is 25
right.
years old now. But with renovation work that we've done, I'd be the first to stand up and say, I think really you could say that the arena is a 10-year-old mm-hmm. facility now. We did a $34.5 million improvement, including raising the roof, that was done in 2002.
Mm-hmm.
2-3 years ago, we did a significant improvement to the expo. So
and another one planned in a couple of years.
Right. Well, an expansion. So,
mm-hmm.
but again, like with you look at the expo, the state of the art sound and lighting systems and what have you. Same can really be true said with the arena. You look at our scoreboard systems, our ribbon boards, our
right.
technology. You know, our technology, we're right up there with. I'll compare us to the new arena that was just built in Evansville, the Ford Center for $134 million. So did we get value? I think we really did. But as a community, we constantly need to look at our assets, and every asset has an end to its useful life.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think we're anywhere near that yet for the Coliseum, but 20 years from now, what will the technology, what will the convention be? We'll have to look at that.
Well, and you were, I think, recently rated in the top 100 on social media, so you're obviously keeping up with, you know, not only the modern technology, but the modern uses of that technology, which I'm sure contributes to your success in attracting acts and customers alike. One thing you do not have going ahead, at least in the reliable form you had in the past, was mm-hmm. the 1% food and beverage tax,
right.
which funded many of the improvements we've talked about. If they fund any improvements out there in the future, you will have to compete for them along with everybody else, correct, and go through the Capitol Board.
That's correct.
Has that been, or do you think it will, moving ahead, a major impediment for you? Obviously, you're weathering it pretty well right now.
Well, we've been fortunate, and our state officials have an understanding of the Coliseum. And at the time that there was a proposal to move the food and beverage tax, those revenues from the Coliseum to the Capital Improvements Board, we were successful in arguing the need to have a stable capital fund.
Mm-hmm.
And the Professional Sports and Convention Development Area Fund, which is much like a TIF area,
mm-hmm.
but it's a specific geographic area that includes the Coliseum, IPFW, the Holiday Inn. Those earned taxes within that fund flow to Indianapolis, but ultimately come back to the Coliseum. That's generating $2.6 million a year. So that is our means today of how we're able to fund our improvements.
Capital improvements. What kind of a cash reserve do you have out there right now?
On operating?
Well, both.
It's not very big, but it's about $1 million, give or take, 900. It goes down a little during the summer and goes up a little in the fall, but we're pretty stable with staying at about that number. And again, when you're netting at the end of the year between $60,000 and $70,000 a year, you don't have a big upswing on that. So we have to be very careful, and we've been fortunate. On the capital side, I think our fund balance is $2, maybe $3 million.
So there's not a lot when you compare that to the cost of some of the things we're talking about.
Well, and when you think of the value of that asset, our appraised value, I think, is in the range of $200 million, something like that. And you think we have 850,000 square feet under roof. So, you know, we have a good capital plan. We're right on top of replacing roofs, taking care of HVAC systems. We're going to be doing some, starting what is toward the last phase of our roof work for the arena right now. So it's quite a project.
Well, you mentioned the Evansville Arena, and I think I shared with you a couple of months ago. I was there not that long ago, and for the money that they spent versus what we have here, I much prefer our building. With the exception of the 60-year-old restrooms, which I know is on your one of your upcoming projects very quickly.
So, yeah, our capital plan this summer, we're doing some storage room expansion. We're putting a new deck, new roof on the lounge out the patio. Yeah, but next summer, the summer of 13, we're working on the 200 level of the arena. And everything from essentially replacing, gutting the restrooms, taking them down the studs, and from fixtures to lighting and everything else, to the corridors, and we're actually adding food courts at that time. And the old, if you think of the old days, the Coliseum and the Parnell entryways, above those entryways, that'll be the food courts.
And you'll be able to pay with credit by that point, right?
Well, actually, that's happening this summer, and we're talking about concession stands. This summer, we're putting POS systems in, automated, think the old days of just a cash register, but now this tracks inventory, gives us the ability to do food specials, and along with the POS system, we're also putting digital menu boards in. So let's say at the end of the night we have 100 hot dogs left. You've heard this pitch already, but rather than charging just $250 and spoiling them out if no one buys them, let's say hypothetically we decide we've got 100 hot dogs, we're going to, you know, something is better than nothing, price them at a dollar, sell them to the community, the people at the event that night. Everybody wins.
Now, if I want a beer and don't want to pay $7, if I wait till the third period, can I get one for $5?
Oh, I'm sorry. Beer is closed, shut off at the start of the third period,
well,
Kevin.
Maybe we can work on that. Let's talk a little bit about you in particular. You are still, I believe, the chairman of the Venues Managers Group worldwide, correct?
Yes, I am chairman of the board of the International Association of Venue Managers, an association that represents approximately 3,800 facilities and managers worldwide.
Now, how did it come to be that Randy Brown from little old Fort Wayne was selected to that?
I think I was fortunate on one hand and again, I've been in the venue business now. It's interesting, we were looking that up earlier this week. I've been involved with facilities for going on 35 years now.
Came from South Bend, right?
South Bend, and actually my very first job was with Indiana University and ended up then at St. Mary's in Notre Dame and then Fort Wayne. And it's hard to believe I've been here almost 25 years now, but along the way, working on a lot of venue-related activities with the association, from arenas committee to you name it, just about at every level. And just in terms of slowly over a period of time, assuming more and more leadership responsibilities, ultimately I was recommended by leadership to work the chairs, run the chairs, and you move up to, you start as second vice chair. Then first vice chair, and now I'm chairman of the board, and it's been a great opportunity, from trips to China.
Well, I wanted to get to that. That took you to China last year.
Yes, that's right.
Looking at their Olympic facilities, among others, because I gather they really aren't getting a lot of use right now, and your mission in part was to tell them, how do you get more use out of what they paid a lot of money to build?
Right.
Give us briefly your take on the trip, not only on what you did there professionally, but the country as a whole.
It was an interesting trip. I was a guest of the Chinese government, and the trip was totally underwritten by the Beijing Olympic Development Committee.
That's so the county taxpayers did not pay.
No, I'm happy to say they did not. And I would say it was an asset, though, in terms of learning opportunities. And that's I try to come away from each of these trips with one or two takeaways. And looking at the Bird's Nest, which is the large Olympic stadium in Beijing, the water cube where the water activities took place, and then ultimately to Tianjin and another facility. Just to make a parallel here, the Dallas Cowboys Stadium was built for $1.4 million.
$1.4 billion.
The soccer stadium in Tianjin, which is about 3 hours outside of Beijing, was built for $3 billion. Somebody did not get their money's worth. So, and that's really part of the problem with China. And every morning, if I'm walking, I like to run in the morning, and you'd see hundreds, thousands of people out on the streets, sweeping the streets with with old, pretty ratty brooms. And I asked my translator first, and we got in a conversation with the government official why they do that. And it's the same thing with their facilities. They were explaining to me that they have to have employment for their people. It's a communist system. Everyone has to contribute something to the country, and that's part of it. The way, when they build an arena, when they build a stadium, they're not looking for a facility that's going to last for 60 years. They don't want it to last 60 years. They want something that is going to be useful for the time period that they've identified, but at the end of that time period, they'll tear it down and they'll build another one. And that's just part, again, of their use, but also how they keep their people employed.
So that's changed a bit since they built the Great Wall, apparently.
Apparently so.
But I guess the point of all that is, and I know you've talked about it before, you don't do these things just for Randy Brown or even the organization. I think you've said, and maybe talk about it a bit, there is and can be a tangible benefit to the Coliseum and to Fort Wayne by virtue of the contacts that you make doing all this.
Absolutely, and I'll answer that a couple different ways. First and foremost, being high profile helps so that when agents, managers, and a lot of these people that are making event decisions now, we've all grown up together. So I can remember when most of us were young managers, we were waiting for our turn. Well, now it's our time. So we're making decisions on where events go and what, you know, from pricing to you name it. So it's a great opportunity. And for the most part, if I call one of the senior managers at William Morris or Creative Artists Agency, they'll take my call. So that's not typical within entertainment. The other thing is that being active with the association, in addition to getting events for Fort Wayne or helping to get events for Fort Wayne, it also helps us as there are industry-related issues. I'm heavily involved on getting briefings with Homeland Security, so understanding what the risks are and helping to set policy as an industry so that you know, we're being reasonable with what those demands may be, but also being proactive. And the one thing we're constantly looking at is safety first for our citizens. On Monday of this week, I was part of a meeting and advisory group that met in Indianapolis that's helping with the stage collapse in Indianapolis that is ultimately setting the new policies, procedures that we hope will roll out across all 50 states that'll determine how venues operate, outdoor venues, indoor venues. And I'm happy to say that I was one of the few Hoosiers that were part of that panel and able to give some recommendations to our elected officials.
Of course, outdoor events is really one thing you don't have to worry about a whole lot, although you do have a Goldwing coming in July, which will be, right, what, 10,000 people, give or take?
We hope so, but I have spent 17 years with minor league baseball and the Wizards. So
that was my point. You've been stadiumless now for, what, 3 years. Has that been a net loss to the Coliseum, or have you kind of, I know you wanted more parking, so you've had that benefit, but how have you weathered that, do you think?
Well, it's been almost a double-edged sword. On one end, we had to lay some staff off. That was one of the hardest things that I've done in my time here. Mm-hmm. You know, when you've got people who, you know, again, you work together for 10, 15 years, and then one day call them in and let them know that, I'm sorry, we no longer have a position for you. That's hard. You know, they were crying, I was crying. I mean, it was just a terrible situation, but we had to for the budget. Going beyond that, with the stadium and the baseball team, I used to always say it's not so much what we make during the summer with having minor league baseball, it's what we don't lose during the summer. Mm-hmm. Because just the way the revenues, how the revenues flowed to the team. So it's been an adjustment period. We are a much leaner operation now. But we did need the parking too. So with raising the roof, with the size of the events that we're hosting today, you know, an event like Elton John, we used 90% of the parking available on property. So,
and if you'd have had something else going on, you would have used
Well, we actually, the night of Elton John, we had three or four other events, from Derby Girls to Quincy Era and other events taking place. The Coliseum rarely hosts just one event. We can do up to 15 different events at the same time today.
And it has not been unusual, though, that you've had to do shuttles to even off-site parking when you've had multiple big acts. So, you know, the stadium comes and goes, and like you say, you take the good with the bad.
Right.
And I think overall, even you might have to admit, although maybe you wouldn't publicly, that the downtown stadium has worked pretty well in terms of fan support and
That. It's a wonderful asset for the community. You know, the Tin Caps and Mike Nutter and crew do just an exceptional job. You know, I'm very proud of our downtown and the stadium, and yeah, I think today we've got out-of-town company, and to drive around the city and show off what we have here, we've got a lot to be proud of.
Well, and I know we've talked about this before, but do you consider yourselves competitors with downtown or complementary?
Oh, absolutely complimentary. I had a conversation today with Bob Lister, my counterpart at the Grand Wayne Center, and the nature of the events that we host are different. Really, the amount of overlap where we could be viewed as competitors is, you know, it's maybe a couple percentage points. It's small. Grand Wayne is 50,000 square feet, their biggest room. We're, you know, the Expo is 100 plus thousand square feet. We've got 170,000 square feet total exhibit space. Our average show is 80,000 square feet of space. So we clearly complement each other. We try to work together where possible to encourage events to come to the to Fort Wayne in the Coliseum where it's appropriate, and the Grand Wayne when it's appropriate there as well.
Well, tell the people watching about some of the exciting things you might have coming up that maybe people don't know about yet.
Well, you mentioned the Goldwing Road Riders event. That's 4th of July weekend this summer. That's going to be great. Coming in May, the Quilters will be back with an event May-June. I don't remember the exact dates of that. We've got some great concert activities, some that we can talk about, others. That's interesting that in my position, I work pretty much at the mercy of agents and managers. So when they call, it's a matter of you just stop. And if we're going to work out a deal for a concert, you do it right then and there. And during listening to the hockey game last night, it was one of those moments where, okay, the manager wanted to talk, work out the deals related to an event. We do it, and it's done, and we move on. To date, we have now confirmed a total of 11 concerts for this year. We're off to a great start, and some of them you know. One of your favorites, Five Finger Death Punch, will be
here in
July, but also one that goes on sale on May 5th, and that's Van Halen.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because you sent out an alert this week about some bad information getting out on ticket pricing.
Right.
Talk a little bit about that and whether that problem is isolated to that, or is it a kind of a more universal problem in the promotion business?
Well, it's a huge problem, and there are entities out there. We're talking about the secondary ticketing market,
right,
and which is, if you use the word, scalpers. Mm-hmm. And some of it, frankly, is just out-and-out fraud. It's if you look right now, if you go to one of those sites, you'll see they have specific sections and seats noted available for Van Halen. We haven't even put the show on sale yet, so they cannot possibly have tickets, let alone identifying any specific section in the building. Mm-hmm. It's interesting, in some cases, they identify sections or seats, rows that don't even exist. We've had situations
at a much higher price than you would charge.
Well, the price, and what caught our attention with this is that it was noted in local media that the ticket prices for Van Halen were going to be, I believe, a low of $125 and a high of like $350. And we tried to explain to the reporter how she had gotten on one of these secondary ticketing sites on their website, and that was just incorrect information. Well, unfortunately, it was reported. It really became quite the talk of people attending the Elton John concert. Now, the real information, and we're still tweaking the ticket price, but we're pretty much there, is that the low price is going to be $39, not $125, $39, and the high price is going to be $99. So dramatically different. And we're part of an advocacy group called Fans First. And it's a group of facilities, of agents, managers, promoters, who are out to try to do everything possible to shut down these secondary ticketing sites, the illegitimate ones, the ones that are taking advantage of our unknowing consumers. And we want to make sure that we put the word out that when you want to buy tickets, make sure that you're going to the right website, going to the Coliseum, memorialcoliseum.com, going to ticketmaster.com. Mm-hmm. Don't go to some site that you're not sure of. Don't give them your credit card number, because we've had a number of situations lately where guests have gone to those sites, they've given the information, they've paid a lot of money for tickets, they come to the building the night of the event, only to find that that ticket is counterfeit.
And they probably have little recourse at that point, correct?
Very little. And unfortunately, we're not in a position to just be the good guys and say, don't worry about it, come on in. Because we, you know, at the end of the day, it's all a business.
Sure.
But that is out and out fraud. So we're trying to educate the public. We're trying to create industry barriers so that we can, through lawful means, put these people out of business.
Well, you talk about scalping, and I've always wondered why people stand outside the rotunda door at the Coliseum, you know, either buying or selling tickets, sure, with apparent impunity. So I don't know if you don't have any problem with that, or they kind of do it under the radar. But
well, Indiana does not have ticketing laws, mm-hmm, so right now we do not have the legal ability to prevent that. But I will say that the majority of the tickets that are resold out in front of the doors and